The guy I'm going to be meeting today seems to have done nearly everything in the movies. He's worked with everyone from Marilyn Monroe to Doris Day to Al Pacino to Jimmy Cagney, and he's been directed by everybody from Oliver Stone to John Ford to George Cukor to the great Billy Wilder.
Where is it, Chloe? You want some water or something?
He seems to have really pushed himself as an actor. He was in one of the most daringly political films of the 1980s, which was Missing.
Okay.
Terrific.
The loneliness he expresses through his character C.C. Baxter in the 1960 film The Apartment pierces your heart. And I think in Some Like It Hot, he is full of the simple joy of being alive.
But you sit here.
All right.
Have a nice close view of yourself on the telly.
Oh, my God. I may throw up.
One critic said he is our clown for the age of anxiety. I've never met him and I can't wait to. His name is Jack Lemmon.
So, first of all, what do you feel about looking back over your old movies?
I'll tell you the truth. The times that I've, that if I'm flipping around on television, for instance, and one of my old films comes on that I haven't seen or thought of for years and years, then I have a tendency to want to watch it for 10 or maybe 15 minutes. But then I'll usually flip off because I begin to see more wrong than I see right in what I was doing. The glory of acting to me and why I really respect it so much as a craft and as what can be an art is because it can go beyond just entertaining. With the right material and the right part, you an actor can do something that very few of us have the chance to do, and that is to move somebody and to enlighten them and make them think in a way that they never would have thought if they had not seen that performance.
When you look back in your career, what's striking is you've made a number of films that are in some way critical or questioning of corporate America. And I've read that your wife, Felicia, helped to make you become more politically aware. Is that right? You seem to
I think so, yes. She's very well read, much better read than I am, I must say. But I'm catching up.
And you started to become interested in environmental issues?
Yeah, I became interested really when my son Chris, who is what, 42, when he was born and I brought him home from the hospital in a basket in the back seat of a car, it was a smoggy day for then here in Los Angeles, and I suddenly said to myself when we were halfway home, I said, this kid is breathing a carton of cigarettes a day already. Huh. So I just became more aware, I think, of various social and political problems.
Yeah. Now, before we go any further, you were saying that you were going to wear an eye patch today, like old Ford. Why is that?
I just want to say, if my eyes look odd at any time, I've got some strange virus that's affected my left eye and it won't move. So if I look like I'm totally cross-eyed or my eyes look funny, that's the reason why. This eye won't move.
And so you can see two of me?
So I see totally two distinct people sitting right beside me.
How terrible
even
for you.
Close. You're both very nice.
Now, let's wind the clock right back and look at the first film that you made.
Oh, yeah. It Should Happen to You.
Yeah. What are your memories of that film?
Oh, wonderful. It was the first time I had been out to Hollywood. Yeah. Up until that time, I had had no desire whatsoever to do a film, let alone sign a contract with anybody. My first love is theater. That's the purest form of acting. That's the complete thing. I mean,
but in theater, you can't take close-ups. This camera's probably taking a close-up.
I know. They can do a close-up on the rotten eye if they want. But in the theater, you've got to be prepared from head to toe every night. You know, and every second of every night, and there's no retakes. You blow a line, you blow a line. That's it, kid. Uh-huh.
So It Should Happen to You. It's a story of the wonderful Judy Holliday wants to become famous, wants her name in lights.
Yeah.
And you meet her, and you try and convince her other ways of some sort.
Yeah, exactly. I'm a young documentary filmmaker.
Yeah.
And I keep trying to say, what do you want to be famous for what?
Yeah.
And she finally buys a sign in Columbus Circle in New York, and puts her name, Gladys Glover, on the sign.
It's such a modern idea, isn't it?
Yeah. it had something to say.
Yes.
It was a script of substance, aside from being funny. It was directed by George Cukor, who was one of the great directors.
Great directors.
Everybody always thought of him as a woman's director, but he was just a plain actor's director and a marvelous one.
I've got one of the fight scenes here. Will we have a look at?
Oh, have you?
Between
go
you
ahead,
and
yeah.
Judy.
To think I actually know a grown-up, civilized woman who can take a hard-earned cash that might do some good for her or somebody, just take it and throw it away on a nonsense. It's all garbage.
You hear me?
No. Oh, sorry to stub it already, but you see when you're clutching your stomach there?
Yeah.
I heard that Cukor said to you, what would you do really if you were doing this scene? And
yeah.
You said, I feel I would throw up. Is that right?
Yeah. I told him that when I get really mad, I get sick to my stomach. And so he said, use it. Do it. So we did it.
Do you know what's very interesting, Jack? Having watched all your films very recently, again and again in your performances, you clutch your stomach as if in some way your characters are all these people who have got ulcers, people who are sort of in some way too anxious about the world.
I think a lot of it, yeah, is unconscious too.
Yeah. Okay, let's watch the end of this.
All I did is happen to meet you in the park by accident. So I don't see where that gives you the right to tell me off.
Correct.
And furthermore, different people do different things that may seem crazy to other different people. That doesn't make it.
Correct.
And furthermore, do me a favor and butt out.
Oh, would you please do me a favor?
Like what?
Do you remember my name?
Sure.
Or what?
Pete Shepard.
Well, do me a favor and forget.
Oh!
So is it still on for Friday lunch?
Certainly.
Thank you very much.
Don't mention it.
And that was your idea, that false ending, to come in and out?
Yes. Yeah, I remember when I've read the script, I thought, oh boy, what a great... That's a very legitimate laugh, to make a false exit, come back in, and then out.
The next clip I've got is from Mr. Roberts,
your
first Oscar. And the scene I've got here is when the very funny scene where you first see Cagney. Cagney doesn't know you're on board. You've been on board for 14 months,
yeah.
And he doesn't know you're there. And I read that you and he had real problems not laughing when you did this scene. Is that right?
Yeah, I'd look above his eyes, or I'd look at his Adam's apple. But if I looked him in the eye, I'd start to go.
Okay, let's have a look at this scene.
Who's that? Who's that officer? You boy! Yes, you. Come here. Are you one of my officers?
Yes, sir.
What's your name again?
Ensign Pulver, sir.
Well, I'm glad to see that someone aboard this vessel knows how to salute. Pulver. How is it I don't see you around much, Pulver?
I often wondered the same thing myself, sir.
What's your job, Pulver?
Officer in charge of laundry and morale, sir.
You didn't do many outdoorsy parts. You weren't a kind of outdoorsy kind of guy, sure you weren't. It was mostly indoors, you know, domestic scenes.
Yes, yeah.
And I've got one of your few outdoors films coming up now, which is Fire Down Below. Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah, surely.
What do you remember of that?
Mainly having great fun. The people were so nice. Bob Parrish, who's no longer with us, directed it. And Bob Mitchum, who also is not... I must be killing everybody off. I don't... Anyway, he's no longer with us. And Rita Hayworth is no longer... I'm the only one left out of the whole damn
not
film.
At all.
But at any rate, they were all wonderful people. We had great fun.
Yeah.
And I enjoyed working with them very much.
Rita Hayworth doesn't look very happy in this film. This is way after she did Gilda and all those classic roles. What was she like?
She was a lovely, lovely lady. It's interesting, when I was walking around the lot at Columbia before I left to go on location to start filming this, people in the makeup department, cameramen, camera assistants, guys would come up to me and ladies and say, do me a favor, give this to Rita.
Uh-huh.
And they'd always have a note, you know, saying we love you and so forth.
I think it's quite disturbing to see her in this film in some way. There's one, the great dance scene where she really goes wild and lets her hair down, and you see this is the Rita Hayworth that we've seen before. And I guess it's because she's playing a shady character, isn't she? But she's very emotionally imprisoned.
I think it's a combination of the character, who had a lot of problems, plus the fact that she was not that happy herself. She'd been having continual fights with Harry Cohen, who was running Columbia Pictures, and who was tough as hell. Oh, he was a tough guy. And he was grooming Kim Novak to replace Rita, and Rita knew it.
Yeah.
So that didn't help things.
Yes, yes. Okay, here's a scene, you, Mitchum, and Hayworth.
If you happen to see any of us around, you might be advisable for you to pretend you don't know us.
We can't just drop her like this in the middle of this forsaken hole.
Why not? That was a bargain, wasn't it? We were to take her to Santa Ana, the responsibility ended.
You do have a mean streak in you, don't you?
I said I'd bring her here, and I brought her here. What's so mean about that?
Somebody has to see the girl into the town. You defeat me. I don't know what you're aiming at. You're trying to get chosen for the Brute of the Month Club or something?
Joke. Push off, Jimmy Jean.
No, hold it. You're on your own from now on. I leave my stuff on the boat. I'll pick it up later.
What's interesting, Jack, is that even in those outdoor movies, you're often pitted against a hard man, and often you're usually the decent man. Isn't that right? Like, you're decent there, you're thinking of her.
Yes.
And it happens again in Cowboy, that Western that you're in. You're the decent one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Most of the time, in the major pictures that I have done, the character must make a major decision. Moral, ethical, political, social, whatever. It's a major decision in his life. Mm-hmm. In the apartment, he turned the key back in and said, no more.
Great scene.
In Save the Tiger, he chose to burn the factory down to collect the insurance just to stay in business. In The China Syndrome, he's the guy in the white hat. He's the good guy because he's willing to cut the umbilical cord and sever everything he loves, which is nuclear energy, which I personally am against, but that's that doesn't matter. That doesn't affect the character or the writing and the performance. And he's willing to blow the whistle on a factory that has a fault because it could be dangerous. And he knows it's going to destroy his career in what he loves, but he does it because it's the morally right thing to do.
Mm-hmm. And after you made the film, the Three Mile Island incident happened, isn't that right?
Yeah, about 3 weeks later.
And so this is a film about a nuclear disaster, and then there's a real nuclear disaster, bigger than the film anticipates.
Yeah, and everything that we talked about in the film, which so many people criticized as saying those things could never happen, everything did happen.
Yeah. You know? Right, now we've got a film that comes at the end of the 50s. It's Some Like It Hot.
Oh, yeah.
It seems, in a way, one of the first times that you really were pushing yourself creatively.
Yeah. If it wasn't Billy Wilder, I don't think I would have done it. Mm-hmm. I remember a couple of weeks into it, I thought to myself, you're either in a classic or the worst comedy ever made, one or the other, and I didn't know which.
Yeah.
Except we were having great fun, and I loved Billy. But I think in the hands of somebody else, it could have been awful.
Yeah. Were you consciously trying to, you were a studio guy at Columbia, were you constantly trying to get a broader range of parts? Was it just lucky that such an unusual part came along?
Well, it's lucky that Billy wanted me for that one because they wanted Frank Sinatra, Danny Kaye.
Frank Sinatra in a frock?
In his way, I think he might have been wonderful.
Okay.
Please mute.
Up to daisy.
Fresh.
Looks like Paul Yakov came through with a couple of real ladies.
You better tell the other girls to watch their language.
Like the name Geraldine.
learned to know me again.
You'll be sorry.
Take off your corsets and spread out.
Oh, well, I don't wear one myself.
Don't you bulge?
Huh? Bulge? Me? I have a most divine seamstress. Comes in just once a month. Oh, my dear, she is so inexpensive.
Come on, she's
all right.
The reason, Jack, I put this clip on the roll is it points out so clearly the way your character became one of the girls in a way, more than Curtis's character.
Yes.
Into the lingo, of course.
Yeah, he really believed it after a while. You know, it's later on when he... Oh, this is Chloe.
Chloe's very nice. Do you want to look at the camera?
Say hello, Chloe.
She's not good.
Say hello to everybody. Anyhow, my character, you know, later on goes out and gets engaged to Joey Brown. And when Tony says to me, how can you do that? I say, why? What's the matter? Well, you know, guys get engaged, girls get engaged all the time. He says, yeah, but you're not a girl, you're a guy. I said, well, I'm a guy. I have to convince myself because I've talked myself into it. Mm-hmm. Like an actor talking himself into a part, you know.
But it's even more complicated than that because you become one of the girls in some way and yet you look less like a woman than he does. Your makeup is more comic, isn't it?
Yeah.
Tell me about how you worked on that makeup thing.
Oh, we worked like mad. I had a crazy guy named Harry Ray, whom I miss to this day. He passed away. Everybody I'm talking about has passed away. Who did my makeup, and Emile Levine, who's a very good makeup artist, did Tony. And we worked side by side every day for a week, trying wigs and different makeup styles. And finally, I said, Harry, I'm thinking about my mother now, when I was very, very young. And it was sort of after the flapper days of the 20s and the 30s. I said, try bee sting lips. So he did some bee sting lips in the makeup, and I sort of pursed him and looked at him, and I liked it. And then we arched the eyebrows and moved them up a little bit. And then I put a wig on that reminded me of my mother. Basically, what I was doing was my mother, the way she looked when I was a kid, as I remembered her.
I'm sure she wasn't very pleased.
When she came, she thought it was a hoot. And she came down on the set to visit, and she took a look and let out a scream in the middle of a take. And Billy turned and said, Mother, what are you doing? Anyway, she kept laughing all during all the takes, and I had to finally tell her to go sit in the corner and please be quiet.
I've got here the scene from Some Like It Hot with you and Marilyn Monroe in the sleeper compartment.
Do
you remember that scene? I read that... You know, she's famous for doing like 40 takes or something.
Yeah.
Did she do it here?
One take, the whole thing. And Billy said, Marilyn, do you want to do another one? She said, no. And he said, that's it. It was the first shot in the morning. It's the only time I think she ever did one take in her life.
Uh-huh.
And it was not that she was not capable or that the director would cut. She would cut because she didn't feel right.
Yeah.
Whatever it was, an alarm clock went off in her brain and just said no, and she would stop.
So you must have dreaded scenes with her then?
In a way, except I liked her very much, and we got along great. And I knew that she had problems and that she was not happy. Mm. I didn't know why, but I knew that she was basically not happy. Mm-hmm. It was none of my business. I never pushed it, and we never got close enough for me to find out what her troubles may have been. I mean, we all know she had troubles. But the biggest problem really was not that, it was her lateness.
Yeah.
Because she just would not come onto the set and shoot until she felt ready. Mm-hmm. And it was not temperament at all. It really was a psychological thing with her. Mm-hmm. Until she could face that camera, she wouldn't do it.
And you didn't know she was pregnant? You didn't know she had a miscarriage during this film?
It
makes the film more poignant, I think, when you know that.
Yes.
You said a fascinating thing, which was when you were playing scenes with her, it's like there was a glass wall between you and her, and yet what, when you looked at the rushes?
Then you'd go to the rushes and you wouldn't look at yourself, you'd just look at her. Because it seemed like nothing was happening.
Yeah.
But it was happening between her and the lens, if not between her and you. You know?
Do you think she would have been good in the theater? You know, we talked before about the theater, or was she a coincidence?
I personally don't think so. I don't know, we'll never know, but yeah. I don't think so.
Hmm. Right, let's look at this.
I think she had a magic on film.
I'm not crowding you, am I?
No, it's nice and cozy.
Look at your boobs sticking out.
I used to go out to bed with my sister. We'd cuddle up under the covers and pretend we were lost in a dark game. We're trying to find our way out. Anything wrong?
No, not a thing.
The poor thing, you're trembling all over.
It's ridiculous.
Your head's hot.
Ridiculous.
You got cold feet.
Isn't that ridiculous?
Here, let me warm up a little. There. Isn't that better?
Yes, I'm a girl.
What'd you say?
I'm a very sick girl.
Oh, I better go before I catch something.
I'm not that sick.
I've got very low resistance.
Oh, a little dash of sugar. If you feel that you're coming down with something, my dear, the best thing in the world is a shot of whiskey.
One of the things, Jack, that interests me was you, apparently when you were making this picture, you said you were, I think you were worried about the, you weren't getting any close-ups, is that right?
Oh, yeah, I worried in the first week, 2 weeks.
Yeah.
I was aware that Charlie Lang, I think, was the photographer, who was a famous
old
photographer.
He died just last week.
Did he?
Yes.
There's another one gone.
He died just like last week. At the grand old age of 92.
I'm not laughing at the
sorry, I didn't realize
God,
you didn't know that.
I didn't know that.
I should have told you.
Oh, God.
And anyway, he was 90-something, so that's a good innings.
The old master, the professor, they called him,
okay,
I think.
Yeah.
Anyway, Charlie, when he was lighting, and Tony and I were together all the time, of course, yeah, through the film, most of the time, especially in the first half, he'd use a key light for the two of us, and then before we go, he would put a scrim over half of the light that was on me. So I thought, I worried if that would automatically draw
yeah
too much attention out of the two characters to Tony.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't mean it selfishly. I just thought, really, professionally, would this draw too much attention to Tony, who was brighter on the screen than I was? I don't know whether I ever told Tony this or not. Anyway, so I went to Billy, and I said, Billy, Charlie puts a scrim up over me. Am I going to be too dark? Are you thinking this? He says, of course not. I would never do that. He said, that's on purpose. He said, I don't think you need to worry too much about how you're going to come out in this film. And so I just took his word for it, and it was fine from then on. I never even thought about it.
Okay, here's another bit from the same film. One of my favorites.
Pardon me, miss. May I?
Help yourself.
I'm Osgood Fielding the Third.
Cinderella the Second.
There's one thing I admire. It's a girl with a shapely ankle.
Me too.
Bye-bye. Let me carry one of the instruments.
Oh, thank you. Aren't you a sweetheart?
I've forgotten his name, but Billy hired the world's greatest female impersonator to work with Tony and me before we began. He was French, and they had to bring him over on a boat because he wouldn't fly. And he got here, he worked for 2 days, and then went to Billy's office and said, I quit. And Billy said, why? He said, Curtis is wonderful, Lemmon is impossible. He said, he won't do anything that I tell him correctly, and he's just impossible. He'll never be able to play a woman, and that's that, and I'm through. And he got in a boat and he went home. Well, one thing he did show me, which I think is true, is that if you want to walk like a woman, one of the ways to accomplish that is not to walk with your feet, you know,
straight
one beside the other, but to cross them.
Oh, yeah.
So you're walking like that.
Oh, yeah. Let me just see. Do you do that in
and,
this?
I doubt that I do it because I didn't want to do it correctly. I thought it was much more important that Tony be better at it than for me.
You're sort of crossing a wee bit. Anyway, yeah.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah.
I was more interested in being funny.
Yeah.
Than in being correct.
It's funny, already we've talked about a number of ways in which you worked on the visual elements of your performance. And I remember reading that when you were in radio, you fluffed in radio because,
oh God.
Because you couldn't, you weren't a
I couldn't use
actor.
My body. All yeah. I could use was my voice, and I'd have the whole script right in front of me and blow the lines because I was uptight and nervous. And I used to get petrified as I'd get towards the bottom of the page. I said, you're going to have to turn the page. You're going to make noise when you move that paper. Don't make any noise like that. And then I'd blow the timing on the lines. And oh, God. Very often, I use my body, my face, and my hands a lot.
Absolutely.
They're flying all
more
over
than,
the place.
I think more than any other actor, I think.
Yeah.
So then you did a few more pictures, and then you went back to Wilder for The Apartment.
Mm.
It's one of the best sort of American films after the war, and it was written especially for you.
Yeah.
I've got here the scene where where you go and see Sheldrick, played by Fred McMurray, and you've got a terrible cold.
Right.
Now, I'd like to ask you about this cold. You have always, since childhood, had nasal problems and adenoid problems, haven't you?
Yeah.
And again and again and again, your films, your characters have nasal problems and adenoidal problems.
I've got nasal problems.
Yeah.
The character's got them whether I like it or not.
And famously, in The Odd Couple, you're trying to clear your nose, but here's an example where he can't breathe, possibly. And you've got a nasal spray here. Now, tell me the nasal spray story.
Well, when I was rehearsing the lines myself in my dressing room, I noticed I found myself, as I was saying the lines, I involuntarily squeezed very hard on the nasal spray, and a little bit of spray came out. Onto my script and the table and everything, and then I suddenly I started to think, now wait a minute, how can we use this? So then I ran across the street to Beady Eyes, Billy called him, who was our prop man. I've forgotten his full name, and I said, Beady, is there a possible way to empty one of these and put in something that would show, like milk or something like that? He says, let me work on it. So I waited, and then just before the scene, he hands me, he says, try it, use this. So I said, okay. And I said, Billy, I've got an idea. He said, no, you don't. I said, what? He said, don't have an idea, and don't tell me about it, because I may misinterpret what you're talking about and say, don't know. Show me, do it. Don't worry about film. Do it. Do anything you want, anytime. So I didn't say a word to Billy. I just did it in the scene. And the thing shot out across the room, right under Fred McMurray's nose, as I remember. Fred
He doesn't flicker.
He just took a look like that and kept right on going, God bless his soul. And he's not with us. He's not with us anymore.
It's another one. But it's funny you say that about Billy Wilder allowing you that freedom, because what I've heard people say is that you had to stick to the letter, to the word. You weren't allowed to skip a word.
Yes, that's true. Don't fool around with the words.
Yeah.
They were the Bible, what he and Izzy wrote. Izzy Diamond, his partner. Yeah.
Okay, here's the scene that we're talking about here, Jack.
Just let me explain.
You'd better.
Well, about a year ago, I was going to night school. I was taking this course in advanced accounting. One of the guys in our department, this is Jersey, had to go to a banquet at the Biltmore. His wife was speaking him in town. He needed some place to change into a tuxedo, so I gave him the key. And word must have gotten out, because the next thing I knew, all sorts of guys were suddenly going to banquets. Well, you give the key to one guy, you can't say no to another. The whole thing got out of hand and pardon me.
Baxter? An insurance company is founded on public trust. Any employee who conducts himself in a manner unbecoming... How many charter members are there in this little club?
Well, just those four. Out of a total of 31,259. So actually, we could be very proud of our personnel, percentage-wise.
That's not the point, Baxter. Four rotten apples in a barrel, no matter how large the barrel. You realize if this ever leaked out...
It won't! Believe me, it never again.
When you first read the script, did you feel it was political? Was it trying to say something about America and commerce and things?
Sure. I think it was critical of the behavior of people in corporate America, mm-hmm. a certain group of people.
Mm-hmm. And in the early to mid-60s, quite a lot happening in your personal life. Your father died, I think.
Right.
You set up your company, JLM, Jack Lemmon.
Yes.
Did you get more control or something?
More control and more of a say. In what I was doing, if it was a film, for instance, I might not have the final say, but if I was a co-producer or in the production entity to some extent, at least I'd have some influence whatsoever, you know, in decisions, especially when it would come to final cuts and promotion of a film.
And one of the best films that JLM produced was Cool Hand Luke, the picture with Paul Newman. Not many people know that your company produced that.
Well, I just loved the idea that my company could find a property and we could get it done without me being the actor, without that being the driving force behind it, and that it would be that good. Because I think it was a very good film, in my opinion, and most people's, thank heaven. Be able to get an actor of the stature of Paul Newman and know that my company did that. We made that film.
Yeah. Did you ever consider acting in it?
No. Because I was dead wrong for it. You know, I mean, compared to Paul, I could never play that part.
Slow down a little.
26.
Very interesting, because he's the same age as you and roughly the same sort of build and everything, and yet a very different style of performance.
Very different,
very sort of existential, understated. None of that neurosis that you bring to most of your characters.
Yeah, well, quite different. I'd love to work with Paul, but we just have never found the right thing. When he did Cool Hand Luke, he said, I have a script and I'd love for you to play the other guy. And it was a Western, and I said, it's going to be tough to get me on a horse again, kid. And, of course, it was the Sundance Kid. It shows you how bright I am. But anyway, so I also turned down a film that Paul did years before that. It was The Hustler.
Well.
Well.
Another interesting thing, Jack, is that Cool Hand Luke was in 1967. This was the year also of Bonnie and Clyde. It's like a watershed year for American cinema in general. All these new people were coming on board, like Scorsese and Coppola and all these people. The whole movie industry was changing. Did you, as a studio-trained actor, know that this change was coming?
Yeah, I was, I think, a little dense about catching on to it. I was sort of slow. I mean, it from day to day, it seemed to be happening slowly, you know?
Yeah.
I was aware that there were more interesting films being done, because your offbeat films, so to speak, up until this time, were very rare, and they really threw the studios. They didn't know what to do.
But you never worked with Scorsese, you never worked with Lucas, you never worked with Coppola?
No.
So far. Why was that?
I don't know. The phone hasn't rung.
Uh-huh. 1968, you did The Odd Couple.
Right.
I've got a scene here where you're clearing your nose in the restaurant. Let's have a look.
What's the matter now?
Now, I got this, my ears are filling up. I got this sinus condition. It's the change in temperature. I always get it from air conditioning.
Well, maybe it'll go away.
No, it's all part of my allergies. I get them in the summer.
Only in the summer?
And in the winter, too. I get them all year long. Allergic to foods. And pillows and curtains and perfumes. Can you imagine that? Allergic to perfumes? I used to drive Frances crazy. For a while, she couldn't wear anything except my aftershave lotion. I was impossible to live with.
Stop that, will you? What are you doing?
I'm trying to clear up my ears. Nah, you create a pressure inside your head. It opens up the eustachian tubes. Nah. 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 Nah.
Did it open up?
Uh-huh. I think I strained my throat.
Why is that so funny?
I don't know why it's so funny, but I'll tell you, I barely got through it. I kept cracking up at Matthau with his reacting to it and smiling at, you know, that sort of self-embarrassed smile to other people, you know.
Great scene.
We repeated in
Odd Couple 2. Jack, in the early 70s, you made a picture which apparently, on the way home from the set or the location, you cried. The car and Save the Tiger, which we've talked about. Why did you cry?
It was one of those things that actors have to be very careful of. The part began to take me over instead of me controlling the part. Now, in Save the Tiger, the guy was walking around having a nervous breakdown, and I didn't realize the extent to which I was involved. I started cracking up on the way driving to work in the morning. And then about the third morning when this was happening, apparently I was sobbing like mad while I was driving down the freeway. And a cop pulled me over and he recognized me and he said, "Are you okay, Mr. Lemmon?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know why. I was thinking about a scene that we're going to do." And he says, "I'm going to follow you." He said, "Just, you know, to make sure you're okay." Once I knew it, never happened again. I was okay. This was about halfway through the film.
And you got your second Oscar for this film. And there's one bit in it where your character decries the fact that the younger generation doesn't know who Goebbels is, for example, doesn't know about the Nazi period, doesn't know history. Is it true when you toured with Billy Wilder in Europe publicizing The Apartment, and you went to Berlin and everything, and Wilder didn't tell you that his family had died in the Holocaust?
Yeah, and we were walking down a street. I took a little walk with him one afternoon. We got out of the car at one place, one spot, and started walking down a street. And it was like a series of brownstones. And each house that we passed, all you could see was bullet marks all over the place, you know, in the sides of the buildings and the front, all the edifice was just pockmarked, like the buildings had measles. And he stopped in front of one and looked up and then got very teary. And I said, what's wrong, Billy? And he said, "We lived there."
Let's look at this scene from Save the Tiger. It's the bit where you say, "Don't sell me America." Do you remember that great scene?
Yeah. "Don't you understand? It's people like us, people in the middle, that made this country work. And when people like ourselves get into this kind of thing, it takes it all down. That's what's ripping the country apart."
"Son of a bitch, don't you sell America to me. I've got friends over there sitting under the sand with bikinis on their heads." "I used to get goosebumps every time I looked at that flag. When I was a kid sitting alone in the room playing the radio, if they ever played the national anthem, I stood up all alone in the room. I stood up at attention. Don't sell me America." "Now they're making jock straps out of the flag."
Well, that's good writing.
Yeah, good acting as well.
What it really is an example of how good men can do indecent things. Mm-hmm. He lost the whole damn thing. It's the misuse of the American dream. so to speak, which is misused all the time because it becomes so material. Mm-hmm. You know, a pool and a Cadillac and the right schools for the kids. But to Harry, his life really is summed up in my favorite line in the entire film is only two words. And that is one night in his factory, he's walking around and the old tailor is still working there. And the old tailor says, Harry, what do you really want in life? And he thinks for a few seconds and then he says, another season, meaning another season of clothes to sell. That's it, unfortunately.
Tell me, what do you want? Another season. That's all, another season? Just survival? No dreams, no hope? Hope? You better ask the little old lady in Vegas with a Dixie cup full of nickels. She still has hope. She's still looking for the three cherries. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for you.
Against all odds, we were able to get that film done because nobody wanted to do it. Nobody would touch it. We went barely over $1 million because everybody took scale.
You like worked for $165 a week or something like that?
Yeah. Because we loved it and we wanted to get it done.
Yeah.
And we rehearsed for 2 weeks with the full cast in the locations and shot from page one straight through.
Had you ever done that before?
No.
Shot chronologically?
No.
Okay, the next clip I've got is from Missing.
The story itself was very powerful to me. And getting close to the Hormans and knowing what they went through, you know, touched me very deeply.
On your
this
side.
Is where you visit the ambassador?
Right.
You have all the connections. I'm a middle-aged businessman from New York City. I don't speak one word of Spanish. Here I am. My son may have been shot. Maybe he was tortured. Maybe he was, oh, Lord, beaten so badly that they're keeping him until he's well enough to be released. I don't know. I don't care.
See, look, there's that thing, remember, when you touch your chest.
I don't care. Because what is done is done. I just want you to reach those people and tell them I will take Charles back in any condition. I'm not going to make a stink. I'm not going to go to the newspapers. You make out any kind of a release form, I will sign it. I will absolve anyone, everyone, of everything. I just want my boy back. It's the only child I have, sir. Did you hear what I said?
Yes, I did, Mr. Harmon.
Oh.
Come on, Ed. The meeting's over.
It just seemed such a shame to me that Harmon would have to go through what he did because the government would not fess up the truth. They knew. Our government knew.
Knew that his...
The State Department knew perfectly well all along what had happened to his
son. That his son had been murdered.
But they lied. And Ambassador Davis can say whatever he wants. He had a $2, $3, or $4 million lawsuit going at one point after the film, which he dropped because he would never be able to win it. But what happened in truth was that about 2 years after the fact, through the Freedom of Information Act, Ed Harmon was able to get a copy of a telegram that was sent from the Chilean embassy to Kissinger. The night before Ed Harmon arrived in Chile himself to go to the embassy to get their help in finding out what happened to his son, who was missing. And in the telegram it were detailed about 15 or 20 eyewitness accounts of his son being picked up by the army and taken. So they knew it. They eventually, his body was found in a wall, interred in a wall, and months and months later it arrived home thanks to the government, in a wooden crate that was falling apart.
Finally, Jack, I'd like to talk to you about this gentleman here, Shelley the Machine Levine from Glengarry Glen Ross. Now, tell me about him. What sort of man is he?
Well, again, that's an example of a decent man eventually doing indecent things and rationalizing them. He works in a real estate office, and he cheats. He steals good tips of potential buyers, and they catch on.
This is the scene where your character comes back from having done this great sale, but he's talking to Al Pacino, and he isn't admitting yet that he stole the leads in order to get this great sale.
Now, what I did, I locked on them. I locked all on them, nothing on me, on them. And, oh, God, I am holding my last thought. Now is the time. They signed.
Stomach again.
So fucking great. It was like they wilted all at once. Mm-hmm. No gesture, nothing, just together. No, honest to God. Mm. They both kind of imperceptibly swamped. And then he reached, he took the pen and he signed, passed it to her, and she signed. It was solemn, fucking solemn. Mm. I let it sit, you know. And then I nodded, I said, Harriet, Bruce. Then I pointed into the living room to the sideboard. I didn't know there was a fucking sideboard in there. He went over, he brought us back a drink. Little shot glasses, you know, with a pretty design in them, a little. And we just toasted in silence.
Great sale, Shelley.
It's almost like the camera's pulling back in revulsion there, isn't it?
Yeah. James Foley directed this. Most directors, and I was aware when it was going on, I thought in the back of my mind, this is very interesting. Most directors would have gone in closer towards the end of the scene. He came back. Hmm. He pulled back, and it was very effective.
If you think of C.C. Baxter in the apartment, right?
Yeah.
Is it possible that C.C. Baxter, the middle American, middle-ranking businessman, could he have ever turned into somebody like Shelley Levine?
While we were shooting, several of the actors brought this up to me.
Really?
Yeah. It's interesting. They went all the way back to the apartment and said, do you think this is an extension of C.C. Baxter? And I personally had not thought about it. I think that C.C. had gotten on the right road, without any question, and hopefully stayed on it. Mm-hmm. But if he had the ability to be that easily distracted and lured into doing what he was doing, which was acting like a young pimp, in the apartment, then it's quite possible that maybe later on, under different circumstances, he could be lured off the beaten path again.
Finally, Jack, what is more important for you, a happy personal life or a happy creative life?
I think the personal life has to be more important. Mm.
So if suddenly all the tapes and all the films of your career, all your performances were wiped out?
I would hate it. It would kill me, but I'd rather have that happen than to lose what I have gotten in my personal life, without a question.
Jack, I'm looking forward to loads more great performances from you. It's been an absolute pleasure to talking to you. It's been
so
nice. Thank you so much. It's been lovely.
Thank you. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it as well.
Thank you. Thank you. That was fun.
Are we dressing for dinner?
You know, just come as you are.
So you're pretty good with that racket.
You should see my back end. Will you see me serve the meatballs?